I'd just like to say thank you for having me and welcoming me to Tobago. It's a pleasure being here again, and a pleasure being here again under the aegis of Bokas, who, I mean, it's really something that can't be measured, what Bokas is doing for Caribbean literature, and even for the wider society within which it operates of Trinidad and Tobago. In having these festivals and these events, I think it's a remarkable thing, and I think it's something that we can't stop thanking Marina and her team for. So I would ask you kindly to give Marina a round of applause for organizing this as well.
Okay, although I'm leased up, there's still a little thing that still has to be done. My question to you is, what do you think is responsible for St. Lucia emerging as such a literary giant on the scene?
Okay. I guess it's something I've been thinking about a lot lately. It's a question I've been asked, I think, with increasing frequency of late. I think, well, one of the things, okay, so you have the influence of persons who are very special, right? In any place that you could think of, any island or country, you have somebody who shows up sometimes seemingly out of nowhere, that the conditions that surround them does not really explain what they eventually manifest. If you look at St. Lucia during the time when Derek Walcott was born and grew up, it did not seem like a time that was hospitable and conducive to producing things that were positive. However, however, there's a way in which I believe very much in a certain kind of balance of forces where conflict and confrontation eventually start to bring out in persons certain things that are needed to rectify whatever the situation is. And of course, the colonial experience did that for a lot of our islands, where things were so bad and the status of persons was something so, let's just say, for want of a better word, unsatisfactory, that it started to bring out in people a certain kind of, it started to create in people the very thing that they need to escape from that situation or to ameliorate the situation. Anyway, so that's the general truth of it, which I think is true for all islands. St. Lucia in particular, I think, one of the things I've always made reference to is the fact that there is a constrained language situation, which I think is characteristic of the Caribbean, but I think there's something in St. Lucia that is special in that regard, and that is that when we usually talk about language in Caribbean literature, we usually talk about the language of the so-called the so-called language of the colonizer, which is the English, the standard English, etc. And we speak about the nation language or the folk language, right? Mm-hmm. Which sometimes we call dialect, etc. In St. Lucia, what you have, and it's very interesting because it has to do with the poets in particular, is that you have the language of a so-called great tradition, which is English, but the folk language is not English. The folk language is French Creole, really and truly. So as a Caribbean writer, for instance, coming out of St. Lucia, and let's say trying to be a part of the wider Caribbean, or the wider West Indian, as it was in that time, community, it was a difficult choice to make because, I mean, if you had to identify with the folk language, you were alienating yourself from anywhere else, basically, because that language was not as, it did not travel well, you know? So, and of course, it did not proffer the kind of success and awards and so on that was already inbuilt into that whole English language community, where there was at least that access for that. So I think the situation in St. Lucia is that it's constrained in a number of ways. That it's constrained in the colonial sense of persons judging you on the basis of the language that you use. And in St. Lucia, that's very concentrated. And and the basis that you're moving between almost two cultures. You know, St. Lucians pride themselves, and I think Tobago has a similar history. St. Lucians pride themselves on being seven times British, seven times French, right?
Fought over.
Right, fought over how many?
33 times or 333, right. Depending on who you're
talking. They pride themselves on that. And they were also moving really and truly between two cultures that themselves were at war in Europe, right? And of course, we're seven times British, seven times French, and a million times African, Indian as well. So I think that the special situation that we're looking at in St. Lucia is that you have persons who are now in a constrained language situation that was creating within them the very thing that would rebel against it, or try to negotiate it in some way. And I think poetry is one of the perfect ways, because unlike a lot of other forms, poetry is specifically concerned with language and the use of the use of language to liberate and to explore. So you found that the overwhelming influence became two things in St. Lucia. Poetry, where you found a lot of our poets actually remained within the English language mode of writing. And theater, where a lot of them started to explore the folk voice.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
But as I looked at your book, I kept focusing on you. And I wondered, what in your childhood was key to your wanting to write or becoming such an excellent writer?
I think there's one thing I always mention, but there was something else I think I came to realize after. The first thing, which I normally mention, is that I came from a family that was already very much into literature. My grandfather would be quoting Shakespeare, Longfellow, although I didn't listen at that time. And my dad read and wrote poetry.
Oh, really?
And you know, he was a voracious reader, and also somebody who believed in reciting poetry out loud, which was a major influence for me, because I more and more I'm realizing that I'm unable to separate the writing and reading of poetry from political power, right? And what I mean by that is not to win an election and go into government, but in my own political power as a citizen of St. Lucia, my own political power as a citizen of the Caribbean, of the world. It is an exercise of that kind of will.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess my father was a big influence in that regard, because he was involved in both. He never got involved actively in the official politics, but he had his strong ideologies, and he also used poetry to get them across, right? Not in a propagandist type of way, but in an exploratory kind of way. But the other thing I think is that I started off, of course, with a little, you know, you there's this anecdote about the poet, English poet W. H. Auden, where I think a student came to him while he was teaching at some university and asked him, told him he wanted to write poetry, and they asked him why, and the student said to him, well, because I have important things to say. And Auden was lamenting that, and he was saying basically he would have been more satisfied if the student said to him he liked playing with words, which is what really he saw as making a poet, as opposed to just somebody who has something to say. And I think what apart from the playing in words and so on, there was a sense in which on my mother's end, I inherited a world that I actually wanted to explore and talk about, which is the world of the folk of St. Lucia, of the ordinary people in the island.
Because I would have asked you next, what aspect of St. Lucia's culture predominated in your writing? What stayed most with you?
Yeah, I think it is that world of so-called ordinary people that my mother came from. I think whenever I think of St. Lucia, in terms of, if I had to condense it into a place or into a certain group of experiences, it would be a period in my childhood which I spent in that community going to school. So it's almost like you emerge out of that community, out of St. Lucia, but there's a certain community that defines it for you. And I think that's because this is where the main story, the main battle, the main conflict of the Caribbean story lies. Any nation has a story of its making. We were talking about that yesterday, I think, at lunch with Earl and so on. And I think the narrative of the Caribbean, yes, we have different classes, etc. But the narrative that the man's resolution, the man's attention lies with ordinary people. And everybody has to relate to that story from wherever they're coming from, whatever class, whatever race, etc. They have to be able to relate to that story. And the degree, where they find themselves in society, how they exist, is related to where they find themselves and how much they are willing to engage with that story, mm-hmm. with that narrative.
Do you think any particular skill set is needed to be a writer? I know you said the guy said, because I have something to say. Does that fulfill all that is needed? Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Well, it's certainly not about having something to say mm-hmm. only. Well, and I think that's probably one of where the greatest misconceptions come about. For instance, one of the things you find with some persons when they begin writing is that they believe that the poem can get by solely on the established importance of the subject matter. So for instance, I'm writing about a mother, mm-hmm. and you have such confidence in the universal intelligibility of a mother, of that kind of figure of a mother as something positive, as a giver of life, all the metaphorical associations with it, that you don't put in the effort necessary to craft a properly, a proper poem, a poem that is doing work with language, that is exploring. So you find that, yes, I mean, you're writing a poem about your mother, or you're writing a poem about God, and you assume that everybody, should feel the same way. But you're not doing the kind of work with words that you ought to do. Mm-hmm. That would make it a good poem, to the point that you make the mother look real bad, mm-hmm. because at the end of the day, you did not bring anything, any light to it, you understand? So I think it requires craft, it requires mm-hmm. the willingness and the ability to work. But I think one of the other things I want to say is that, yes, it requires craft, and craft is very important. However, I think there is a sense in which you could get very, very obsessed with craft and forget that you're dealing with a society. I was in communication with the Caribbean poet Kamau Braffitt from Barbados mm-hmm. Recently, and I was just kind of asking him about what's the latest thing that he's doing and so on. And he sent me something where he was talking about moving away from metaphor, something like that, as a center of poetry, and looking at something he called infinite touch, mm-hmm. right? I mean, it's a difficult concept to understand at first, but then he gave the example of, I think when in Shakespeare, in King Lear, when the storm comes, that's about the point where King Lear goes mad or something like mm-hmm. that. But what he's talking about is a certain kind of connection with community, right? Essentially, he's talking about what can emerge out of sensibility. What can emerge out of that level of that depth of connection with a community?
You know, what you said there is so, it resonates with me. Reason is, I heard recently a poem by somebody call it George. And that has stuck with me to today, because the old saying everybody knows, call that George, done with that, And that person was able to take that poem, call it George. And you could have done, just say what we know about call it George, mm-hmm. as you say, put it in the old mundane way. But she was able to show us so many elements involved in this calling it George mm-hmm. that everybody understood, because we use the term, but we don't ever stop to analyze it and see its various forms. You have that term in St. Lucia
yeah.
and call it that George. And it really stuck with me, because it's really two ways of writing. You could have something to say mm-hmm. and say, look, I'm writing about calling it George. But you can go into so many different avenues that brings out that term, call it George. And yes. I was really impressed. I was really, really impressed.
Well, I guess in a sense, this is kind of echoing what Earl was saying yesterday.
That's right.
About showing a society itself.
That's right. In fact, I wanted to ask you if you subscribe to that, and what is the self that you would want to show us by your writings?
Mm. I think one of the things, and hopefully I answer your question, I'm going to ramble probably a little bit, but I think one of the things I'm interested in, and I think it's something I guess I've had to affirm, because I guess I did not feel it around me in that way, is the importance of community, mm-hmm. and not in a sentimental sense, but the actual importance of community in the work that you have to do as an artist and as a writer, and the perception of a community as well, the idea of a community. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've asked some writers, some writer friends of mine, you know, not in a kind of doctrinaire way, but who are they speaking, who are you speaking to in your writing? And it's something that persons are kind of, you know, they feel that it might be limiting mm-hmm. to speak in that way of the work that they're doing. But to me, I've always approached it in the other way. I've always believed that whatever I'm doing, there's a kind of dichotomy between popular artists, an artist of the people, and the artist as the individual who is free and so on. Mm-hmm. And I think that the two are not mutually exclusive at all, that you're actually talking about two aspects of a process. As a member of a society, let's say, I might have different attitudes or what I might think as progressive attitudes, let's say, to homosexuality, which is a touchy issue now or whatever. And I believe that, you know, persons should be treated equally, etc. I have that concept. However, let's say the community that I connect with, the community that I see myself a part of, they're not at that point. Mm-hmm. And they're fighting with it and so on. Does the artist go ahead and revel in the fact that he has this progressive idea about where society should go vis-a-vis its members that are homosexual? Mm-hmm. Or does the artist negotiate that space between him and his community? Right? Because, of course, we're assuming that the artist has something to say that's important, that probably has not been said or hasn't been said in that way. So for me, the popular artist and the kind of individual, solitary artist is two different aspects of that process. I have my ideas, I have whatever I think that might be illuminating, but it cannot be something that allows me now to abandon the society because they're not ready yet. It cannot be that. You'll be frustrated, perhaps, by some of the attitudes that you see, but for me, it still has to be one in which we're willing to work it out. Mm-hmm. We're willing to converse about it for some time. And I think that's, you know, poetry really is about getting to a limitless place via limits. Mm. You have limits of, if you look at a poem, it doesn't go to the end from margin to the end of the, mm-hmm. it stops here. It has rhythms, it has all of these things to kind of restrict it, yes, but to get it to a wider place later, right? And I think that's the kind of thing that that the community and the idea of an audience that you give it a certain importance does for you as an artist, as an artist moving within a society, hoping to make some change, that there are these limits on you, that you're going to have to deal with somebody in front of you with the pressures of dealing, let's say, with an audience. Do people think I'm well-dressed? You know what I mean? I'm just saying, generally, you have to deal with these things. But they also give way to something more limitless, something, a connection, perhaps, or a certain depth or profundity of contact that you will not get if these limits, if these restraints were not there. I mean, I'm using the words limits and so on, and they're not sufficiently conveying what I mean. Well, but I hope that everybody's getting what I'm saying.
I think you're gaining pressure.
Yeah.
Is it when you write, do you write feeling, this is what I want to see and I'm going to put it down? Or do you consult with others? Do you get others' views and then you write? How do you approach the actual writing?
I'll try to answer it in two parts. The consultation process is not always direct and not always official or obvious. Mm-hmm. If you're living in a society, if you're a part of a society, you're constantly consulting.
Exchanging.
You're constantly taking in things. Mm-hmm. You're constantly, you don't necessarily ask the question directly, but you might hear the answer to the question in your head while you're moving about the society. Or at least you might get more interesting questions. Mm-hmm. So it comes from that engagement. That is where the consultation happens. If you're not just walking on the street with your ears closed, thinking about where you're going, if you are open mm-hmm. in that way to what is happening around you in the world, in your immediate surroundings, etc., that is part of the consultative process in which you're taking in the society's thoughts and feelings about things. And of course, that enters the writing in ways that you don't always control.
Yes.
But it's good because you're engaged in something. And of course, the second part is the issue, the very mundane or quotidian issue of craft and you working. In that sense, of course, you consult with people on the basis of craft. Is this good? Is this a good piece of work? Is it doing what it's supposed to do craft-wise? Okay. Or even in terms of what I'm saying, but you're getting it from an adept, someone who works.
So who are the persons that you would have used over time in that kind of sounding ground?
To be honest, during the writing of Sounding Ground, I didn't have direct contact with a so-called mentor.
Mm-hmm.
There were a few people who would give me, you know, sometimes over the internet I would share some things with some folks, and I was lucky enough after a while to accumulate a group of people who would give me comments. But you know, as with the restrictions of social media and these things, very basic comments, but invaluable nonetheless. But I never had, for instance, gone to any workshops or anything before Sounding Ground. Mm-hmm. I was telling Daniel last night that the first workshop I went to was when Sounding Ground was already with the publishers, and we were in the editing phase almost to the end.
Really?
And I just happened to attend a workshop at that point in time. But as I said, there's an indirect way in which you're always honing what you're doing. One of the key ways is imitation, that mm-hmm. I would go and write very imitative poems of very derivative poems of great writers that
I
enjoyed.
I see.
I mean, one of the first poems I wrote was a nearing 40 poem, and I was only 18. because Derek Walcott has a poem called Nearing 40, which I liked a lot. But I wanted to write poetry, and you don't know how, you don't know where to begin. So you start by, let me imitate it and talk about it from, hopefully, my point of view would come through to some degree. And I don't think you ever stop doing that. It becomes, of course, more subtle. It becomes more, of course, there's more of yourself in it after a while. However, it's not something that you entirely stop. I mean, you come across a writer and you see he's doing these very brilliant things and you want to do it. You try it out. You start by imitating. But I mean, you're gaining more and more a concept of self, a concept of who you are and what you want. So there's a way in which the imitation will not affect the work that you're doing in that way. It will become yours, you know?
All right. Now, you said something which I want, especially those of us who try to write among us, is that you're going about your everyday life, and if you are one to be just focused on yourself and where you're going, you would miss out on quite a lot of ideas or opinions or things that could inform your writing.
Yeah.
So we need to remember that when we write, we really write in what comes up from the community, out of the society.
Yeah.
And not keep ourselves too distant from that society. Is that what you were saying?
I am. And I mean, it does not have to be, the final product does not have to be something that is nationalistic.
Mm-hmm.
It does not have to be something that is self-parodying in that sense, that it's so trying very hard to be Tobagonian.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to try to be it if you're confident that you are part of this society.
That's right.
You might not agree with everything they do. You probably don't go to the same churches.
Mm-hmm.
You might not go to the goat races or whatever you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you might think is, you know, the advertised idea of what being Tobagonian is. You engage with it truthfully. You're your own person at the end of the day. You don't have to be doing everything your society is doing.
But I'm saying that man's view.
From whatever your idiosyncrasies are and the personal makeup of who you are, whatever constitutes who you are engaged at society.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always good to have a sense of responsibility.
Okay.
So for instance, you're writing about, let's say, persons who history has not been very kind to in terms of what it has said about them and how it has portrayed them. There's a dangerous thing about an artist coming to that without a sense of responsibility. And it does not mean you're an apologist for these people and you say everything they do is right, but you're at least responsible in terms of what you say. We cannot forget that the history of writing in the Caribbean, I mean, you have so many accounts of persons living in the colony, planters, etc., writing in their diaries. I mean, we have read so much of that. And so much so that it has become part of our vocabulary, part of the way we talk, and so on. that you have to actively, as an artist, be subversive to that tradition that has been said. Because apart from the tradition that we have of, let's say, anti-colonial writing, perhaps that was there from our first generation of writers and so on, you also have a very, very long and stretching, more than it's supposed to. I think Earl was saying yesterday he came across writing like that written in 1973. Mm-hmm. You know, that so we're talking about from 1973 all the way back to the beginnings of enslavement and so on. Mm-hmm. So you have a long tradition as well of writing that denies people their humanity, that denies people their personhood and so on. So we cannot take that for granted. So as an artist, you have to know that you are, in a sense, contending with both of these traditions. Okay. The one that is empowering and the one that is dehumanizing in a way.
All right. Now, I wanted to get into the book and having you perhaps read one or two of your favorite poems in the book. And you can take a little time to illustrate, if you wish, some of the points you've been making. But before we get to that, there has been a debate about the question of whether there is a Caribbean literature. Mm-hmm. What is your take on that? Does the Caribbean, have we produced a Caribbean literature? Or do you think it's a conversation worthy of having, or is it?
Worthy of having in that, I guess you asked the question. Yeah. I need to answer.
But even apart from me asking the question.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I came into this thing very aware of a tradition of Caribbean literature. Mm. I guess I was lucky to have that in the way that persons who, like Derek and Kamau and these guys, didn't have, but they believed in it just as much and probably even more so. The way I guess I normally trace that, to speak of our present time, is there's two videos I watch all the time on the internet, which is one of Kamau Braffitt around 1992, talking about, and he spoke with belief in a sense of an actual, almost physical sense of the Caribbean unity, talking about a cordillera in which there's something going under the sea that connects us all, and we're all literally like a mountain range. Mm-hmm. And he's connecting that to all our kind of spiritual connections and so on across the Caribbean. And there's another one, much later, probably 2 years ago, or maybe 4 or 5 years ago, with Kwame Dawes talking about the change that we went through from West Indian to Caribbean, and also now the very doggedly national consciousness, or consciousnesses, that exist in the Caribbean now. But the Caribbean, as it stands, you know, with the failure of institutions like CARICOM and all of these things, has took on a certain kind of mythopoeic kind of existence and inheritance and tradition that all of us have at our backs when we're writing. Mm-hmm. Whether you consider yourself a Trinidadian writer or a Tobagonian writer or a Trinbagonian writer or whatever, the Caribbean is the same way that for the European writer, the Greek myths and so on formed a serious part of his making, about a part of placing himself in the history. I think Caribbean is very real in that way. And the beauty about it is it is most real, and it has always had to be most real in the imagination.
Imagination.
We don't have the luxury of a place that is connected like that. Mm-hmm. So I think the beauty of it's always had to be a place created by people through the imagination, that we've always had to imagine ourselves bigger than we are on our individual islands. Apart from, yes, the British did this or that, the other, but we've always imagined ourselves even beyond the boundaries of, like, to say, the Federation that was really created by the British and so on. We've always, that's why Caribbean is the important word, not West Indian.
Yeah.
You know?
All right, now, your book. Everybody has a copy? Have you all bought out all the copies there? You have your book here?
No. Well, I left it in my bag. I'd like to read from yours if you don't.
Yes, yeah. And you photographed it so nicely for me. Thank you.
No problem.
Now, what I want to get from you, tell me, what's your favorite in that book?
Which one of the poems? I have a very special kind of relationship with audience, as I told you. And every time I read, I kind of test myself and test the kind of energies that we exchange when we're doing that. And I think there's one poem that I wrote that I think I've been most satisfied with for more than one reason, the kind of exchange that has happened with that poem. And I'm also satisfied because I wrote it for someone. No. Actually, it's someone who there are very few love poems in here. but I taught for 1 year after I had done A-levels, mm-hmm. and I really enjoyed it. And I left for university, and about 2 years later, I found out one of my students passed. Mm-hmm. So I wrote an elegy.
And died.
Yes.
Passed.
Yeah. Passed away. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Did you go to university at UWE?
Yes, UWE St. Augustine. Yes. Mm-hmm. So I wrote the poem for him, and of course, it always helps if you write an elegy, and it's good, you know, that it's felt. You don't want to write for someone for something that's serious and well, like meaningful, if you want to call it that. That you write a poor piece.
Yes. In fact, could that piece also be used at other funerals, like reading at a funeral?
Well, I guess you could be the judge of it. I will read it.
All right, let's see.
If I could find it.
Let me get yours too, because I want to have one in my hand.
Okay, I found it.
Perhaps you might find it easier in your...
Sure. Well, I've gotten it already.
Okay, go ahead.
So
what page is it?
Okay, it's 63.
It's 63, and it's entitled...
For Jorel, who is the student.
For Jorel, page 63.
For Jorel.
Go ahead.
That night she watched the door. She watched. She watched the hours of the door. Her foot blinking like her eye on the floor. She wait. Wasting her time and her mind waiting for this small boy she sent to buy bread ever since. Waiting for this small bread of a boy to come inside and be broken softly under her hot hand of anger and love. And the burn, the bless on his broad back of learned lessons. But all she could do that night is watch the door like a guanom in front her. All she could do was watch the time increasing on the unopening silence. All she could do was watch the clock make her son grow before his time, making him come home so late, so she wait. And she know he must be on the road playing marbles and doing things on the government road that he is supposed to do. But the other boys was doing it too. But I don't care about the other boys. I care about you. And all the talk she talked to herself, all the mop she moped, she couldn't find no kind of comfort, no explanation from clock. And in the middle of her mind, she could see a cock coming. A cock like a cup coming to her door with another day close up tight in its beak. And before it could speak, she see herself start lashing her thigh. And she crow, no, no, no. And the door turned to a mirror, and she walk in, and he walk in toward her, and she walk in, and he walk in toward her from inside the mirror, and she inside the mirror too, but on the next side, and they couldn't touch the boulder of each other's shoulder to roll away the reality. Now she walking out the road with her curlers curl up nice on the bed of her head. And she out in the jumping night of her nightie and her old slipper on her foot, and she wishing she could take it back. Wishing the cock could uncrow the day. Wishing she could take away the chores from his hands, take back the poverty that feed children hunger until they think they big, big, big. But they really big with gas like imagination in their belly. But she on the road now, woman alone, no man to raise the boy, no high chest to brace against when the world has come. Just she, womanly on the road, in the uncertain morning of midnight. But he shoulda know to come home straight, to not wait for no Tom, no Dick, no Harry, to pass his ass home early so none of this could happen. He should have come home in the thick of his skin, smelling of book and ram goat as usual, with the piece of grass between his teeth and bleat under her beating as usual. He should have come home to cry and sleep and wake up wiping the lassie from his eye and say good morning with the sun in his eyebrows and the world in his ears and the trees and flowers in his nose. He should have come home to where the tropical storm of his mother love and lessons was brewing. He should have known. He should have known. No. No. Because dying was an adult thing to do. Something children should be scolded for doing.
This is very deep. This is very deep. You relate to it on so many, many levels. And you said that it really was in honor of someone you knew.
Yes, it was a student who got knocked down.
Oh, right. I was wondering whether he fell to a violent death in terms of being on the street.
Well,
the
poem is actually very much capturing. He was sent to go buy bread, etc., something, mm-hmm. and on the way home, he got knocked down.
Yeah. Very normal story. All right. What do you all think of this one? Would you want to hear another? All right, just give us one more, and then I want to ask you where the idea came from for your name, the name of your book.
Sure, no problem.
All right.
I guess I'll balance it out with one that is not so somber.
And I'm going to ask you, you seem to have a thing with CLR James.
Yes.
We like that because he's of Trinidad and Tobago.
Yes.
So I'm going to ask you what accounts for that.
Sure, no problem. Okay. My grandmother's mind.
What page?
Page 13. Okay. Many times what is on my grandmother's mind is what to cook when she gets home for her husband, the man's man. We call him Papa, like the sound of two quick slaps, like the sound of the catapult slippers that smack his hard foot bottom when he walks out with his man stride, out into the field, pot-bellied and satisfied, like Barbados. My grandmother, Miss Yuli, carries the thought like a basket of unsold produce on her head from the market in Bridgetown, leaving behind the hot memories of arguments and strife, the damp salad of her worries, things that, were she to carry them all in her basket, would weigh her down, would make her not want to cook for this man's man with his man's stride coming in like an ogre from hard working in the field. At the end of the day, nearing Christchurch, she has always known what to cook. But more than that, she has always known what to burn.
Beautiful, beautiful. It's true, we women always know what to cook. Even when we're saying, what are we cooking today? We don't know what we're cooking today. That is so true. How do you know that part? We wake up, oh gosh, we are cooking today. But in the mind, we already seen the stew fish or whatever it is. Great, thank you so much. Tell me about your relationship or your feeling about CLR James.
I mean, it's been a very, very deep connection between me and CLR James from the time I encountered his work.
But because it would be more his work, you didn't know
yes,
him.
Yes, of course. Yeah. And I mean, it was, I think, something so profound for me that there was a point in while I was in Trinidad that I felt I had to find his grave and visit his grave.
I see.
And that's where the poem, I wrote a poem at the grave of CLR James, which is based on that visit. I was taken by a friend of mine from a lecturer from Trinidad, Raul Gibbons.
Mm-hmm.
I think, well, I mean, CLR James, for me, create a lot of bridges between things. I think he wasn't abashed about his connection, number one, to a European tradition.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, he was somebody vigorously affirming an African and Caribbean tradition and very, very confident about that aspect of his heritage. So there was a sense in which he wasn't into the easy kind of exclusion that makes you feel a greater sense of self. So I think that's one of the first attractions to him as a thinker. The other thing about James was, okay, so, you know, the way we talk about there's something essentially Tobagonian or something essentially St. Lucian about us and our experience. And we really believe it, that there's something special about us that makes us different from this person. And I remember coming across the whole theory of existentialism and so on, and it was debunking a lot of that, you know, turning that into nonsense. And it was a little depressing for me, because I always took a certain kind of pride in there was something special that I know we had to give the world, that something special that we had inside of us. And even on a spiritual level, I believed in that kind of essentialism. So that's why I have the epigraph for the whole book, talking about essence. In that, but what it allowed me to realize, and what the quote brings out, that's C.L.R. James again, is that our essence is not so much something that is still and static inside of us. There's not something that is Tobagonian that's there. It is, essence is built by a journey, you know, and a journey that is, it never ends, never really ends. And truly. But there's something that binds us in that particular journey. There's something that only Tobagonians have to deal with in their particular journey. There's something Trinidadians, there's something St. Lucians. So we all have idiosyncrasies of our own personal journey, which gives a sense of community and a sense of binding us together. But it doesn't allow complacency, because it's always journeying. And as he says, it's only when you look back that you realize the ground that has been laid there.
Okay.
You know, you're never totally aware of this thing in a static way while you're moving. It's being able to look back. And that is, I guess, part of the root of the question you were going to ask about the name of the collection.
Yes.
It's both a way of looking back on the ground that has been laid by great persons in the Caribbean, thinkers, family members, everybody who's been producing this ground upon which you stand, all the experiences, and being able to interact with it, to fight with it a little bit, and so on, but also to sound it with a kind of pride in you know, what has been laid there. But it's also the way in which you start to articulate your ground,
yes,
your connection to it, and so on. So I thought
and
it was appropriate.
That to the tapestry of what was already there.
Already there. So it's always, you're always in that kind of conversation.
That's fine, yeah.
So you're sounding them and sounding yourself through them in disagreement with them, etc.
Beautiful. Yeah. So we sounding each other.
Right.
Now, what environment do you work best in? A quiet library, a forest, home in your bedroom? Where do you produce all this good stuff?
I don't know that I have a concept about an ideal environment. Because I guess I've had to work with, around a lot of things while writing this book particularly.
Yeah.
It was at a time when so much was going on in my life. I had just gotten married. I had a son. I was attending university. I was working jobs while I was at university.
Wow.
So I used to end up writing a lot of the time, basically when there was nothing else to do, because I would be so busy for the entire day and up until probably 9 o'clock when everybody goes to bed, and then it's like, okay, I can write. Or, you know, I mean, even before that, I might have to rest and then wake up to write. So it was really, where will I get time to write?
Yeah.
So I really didn't have any kind of notions about going off somewhere and whatever to
like
write.
Like any storybook.
I really had to do it, you know, inter alia amongst everything else that was happening and so on, which was, I think it was a good test for me. It's not something that I say I want necessarily to have to cope with all my life. However, it was something good for me in that I don't know. I was very conscious of not allowing art and these things to make an excuse for me being shoddy at my other responsibilities as father, as husband, as whatever, student. So, I mean, I'm good with that. I don't think I want to be the kind of person who, because they have to do this thing, which is very important, and I do know it's very important, can use it as an excuse for being nasty to people or neglecting responsibility and not being part of, I think, the mundane things that achieve the very things he wants to achieve here. I mean, if I want to change a society and I'm not playing my roles properly, yes, I might be producing great poetry, but if I'm not trying at least to do my best within my circumstances to be a good father, then I mean, I don't know. I'm not sure I could live with that kind of contradiction. you know.
I hear you. Now I'm going to ask here a couple members of the audience. I see Jibu is dying there to make an intervention. So let me get one question while the mic gets to you. The spoken word genre is, if you want to call it that, is emerging, particularly among the younger people. How do you see that? I would have more put you into that. You seem to be the age that fits the spoken word, the image of the spoken word artist. But are you happy about that? What do you think?
Very happy. I mean, I really love it as a genre. And I think we would do well, yes, to recognize it for its own own situation and conditions. Its uniqueness, as in separate from perhaps, let's say, for want of a better term, written word. Mm-hmm. However, as useful as that kind of dichotomy may be, I think it is less useful than seeing it as part of the whole. Of working with language in that way, so which would bind us together.
Yeah,
that way. There's an anthology that came out many years ago, which separated the Caribbean really along these lines. But if you look at the history of Caribbean literature, that is not a true picture of Caribbean literature. I mean, one of the major things that influenced the written word, and Bocas, I think, recognized that. Last year, was a person like Mikey Smith, who we paid homage to last year, who was what he would not be what you call a written word poet, but he had such a lasting influence on the type of work persons were producing in that regard. Linton Kwesi Johnson, who's now published by Penguin, you know, but started off as a And not only that, but it also connects us, our inheritance, in the sense that we've inherited the written tradition largely, by and large, from Europe. Mm-hmm. And we had the oral tradition that has been there, which came largely Africa and so on. What it allows us to do is not only be able to use the resources of both of these things and help them to nourish each other, but we can't forget that the written word tradition was coming out of a certain class of people as well. And for us to start to undermine some of the basic assumptions of that class, we need to have it interrupted or influenced by the sensibility and the worldview that was coming out of our people in that regard. Right? And that's a danger there for the written word. Mm-hmm. Because if you're not interacting for me, in whatever way, I mean, it doesn't mean you have to write a certain way or whatever. If you're not interacting with these things in that manner, if you're really very invested in that duality, then you're likely to end up in a very Caribbean middle class art. And I'm saying Caribbean middle class in a pejorative way. Mm-hmm. Because the history of our middle, free coloreds, etc., as much as they've made contributions, the sensibility is one that has been very dangerous for us, and as well as an elite, as well, you know, when you think of an elite group. So I think, apart from the implications for craft of having the two together, there is a kind of, there's another kind of influence in terms of the way we speak in, and who we speaking to, and how we are speaking, and the way we're going to see the world, and the way we see human beings, and the way we see people. There are implications for that. In regards to, you know, and that's the thing, spoken word does not escape from an audience. It can't do it. It has to deal with that pressure, which is good.
That's correct.
You know?
That's correct.
So I'm not saying we jettison any of them. I'm saying that we have to have them together in a way that we could truly start to change certain things.
All right, now I'm going to come back to you to ask you some of your future projections for yourself and any other thing that you wanted to let us know about. But I think, Jibu, you have your mic. You'll take about two questions from the floor. Go ahead.
You were speaking about C.L.L. James, right? What influenced you about C.L.L. James? Because I used to listen to C.L.L. James and Dunbarton Matthews and these fellas in debates. What it is that you think that you know, our Prime Minister, former Prime Minister Eric Williams, and C.L.R. James had a kind of some kind of thing that was between them. I wanted to know whether it was C.L.R. James's political opinions that caused the kind of rift between he and Eric Williams. Another thing again, in my youth, I was impressed by Jos Lamming from that Barbadian writer. And there was a writer named Emmy Caesar, which I heard Eric Williams mention, which I was looking for the books and was thinking that they might have translated it from his language into English. I want to ask you now whether your writings, you think that you could have them translated into different languages that would appeal to, you know, different audiences and things, you know?
Okay.
Thank you.
I'll start from the last thing you're saying. Some of my poems actually have been translated into Dutch already. Probably about 4 or 5 of them have been translated into Dutch. And I had an offer, I don't know what became of it, but I had an offer on the table to translate the entire collection into French. Hopefully that pulls through. That's in the works. And I mean, if we want to be truly Caribbean, I remember going to a colleague of mine who's from Senegal, but she has been living in the Caribbean for a very long time. And I came with my very rudimentary French talking to her, and she told me, well, you're not truly Caribbean. I mean, if you can't speak French and you can't speak Spanish, then you're not truly Caribbean. And as much as it might sound ridiculous and sound like a lot of work, it's actually true. You're not saying that everybody will get to do that, but I think, I mean, I enjoy connecting with people. And if we really want to get a sense of the Caribbean, I think it helps to at least, if not necessarily, have the language of these places, but to be looking at them nonetheless. Brazil, for instance, is a place that has been very illuminating for me in terms of, I don't speak Portuguese, but looking at Brazil and its history and so on. I think you were speaking about Eric Williams and C.L.R. James. Funny enough, it's something I've actually been thinking about as well. I've read about it. I read C.L.R. James's book, Party Politics in the West Indies, which kind of talks about his rift with Eric Williams and his rift with the PNM, I think, at the time. And I recently watched a film written by, I think it's Marielle Brown. No, Marielle Brown is a producer. It was written by Alake Pilgrim, who wrote the script, on Eric Williams, which is a brilliant documentary. If you don't know about it, it's called Inward Hunger, which is, it's a really well-done documentary on him, on the man. Because I think that generation of leaders are not easily understood. I think, I mean, they're very polarizing figures. It's either you find people who really dislike Williams or some people who really like him. At least in my experience, you very rarely find people who are a little more in the center about him. I think I'll just give you a very basic answer from my very basic understanding of it. I think I read Capitalism and Slavery, which is the book that really, I guess, endeared Eric Williams to me. But there is a kind of fissure between Eric Williams, the man who produced Capitalism and Slavery, and the man who eventually became Prime Minister. And that's nothing to say about whether he was good or bad. I'm saying it in a very vague way, that there is a kind of fissure between the man who wrote Capitalism and Slavery and the man who became the leader. Well, and the father of Trinidad Independence.
He looks different, or he comes over different, or
I prefer to keep my answer vague in that way. For me as well, I don't want to try to pretend to know more than I know either. I just know this is the sense that I have. I read Capitalism and Slavery, and I had read about Williams's rule and so on, and I watched the documentary, and I realized there is a fissure, something I don't know what happened, but there is a fissure between these two persons, and I think, for me, C.L.R. James was a threat to Eric Williams because he was a man very sure of what he wanted, very sure of what he wanted to see in the world. And I think perhaps at the point where he met Williams, Williams was not as sure of what he wanted to see.
From Lavanti there.
Leroy Clark.
What you think of his paintings, and when he talk, you see some kind of the poetry in the man's painting, mm-hmm. and a meaning. So, and I tell him a day, I say, you like Leonardo da Vinci, or you know what I mean? And these fellas, and he started laughing. He said, I paint from what my impressions are, how it comes to me, and it comes out on his canvas, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So, what was your opinion about him?
I'm familiar with Leroy Clark. I actually had the privilege of interviewing him once because I worked in Trinidad with a film television production company. And I got the chance to go to his house and see some of his work and so on. And I had seen, while I was in Trinidad, I was really following the art that was around. I think one of the things I admire most about Leroy Clark, less to say that I am someone who's a fan of his painting in terms of method and what he's doing, is, I suppose, the way he was trying to create a cosmology out of Trinidad, where he talks about El Tukush and he talks about Aripo as the Godhead, etc. There's a way in which he was trying to take things that were very, very indigenous and out of that make it a world unto itself, that it was sufficient. I mean, it's a greater a microcosm of the greater Trinidad and Tobago consciousness that their world is enough. And it's not that there's a hostility to engaging the rest of the world, but they're engaging it with a sense that what we have is enough and what we have is worthwhile, you know? And it's a very taken for granted kind of thing for Trinbegonians that they just say, hey, Trinidad is the best place on earth, Trinidad, Tobago, whatever, you know? So I think that is the thing about Leroy Clark that I could say that I
Is I there like. One more person from the audience that, yes?
I got a very strong message coming out of what you said about the mother's regret about the level of corporal punishment that she had doled, might have perpetrated on her son. Well, she's very anxious waiting for him to come home. I didn't actually know why the son, I realized that the child had died, but I didn't know whether he had met him a violent death outside. But you come, she's full of regret. I am picking up about the physical discomfort that her, the licks, I'm getting the impression that, her son had come in for his share of licks as growing up, and I'm picking up regret. Are you making a statement about the way we deal with our children and the level of physical discomfort that, the violence perpetrated on children by well-meaning parents in the Western tradition? I pick that up very strongly from your poem. I don't have it in front of me, and I wondered if you wanted to comment on that and if necessarily set me straight. But
sure.
I was picking up regret, and that's something that so many West Indians sort of boast of as adults, how much licks I get in school and how much licks I go get when I go home and thing and so on. And that came through very strongly in your poem, and I wondered if you were making a statement and if you wanted to elaborate a little bit more on.
Funny enough, that was really the subject of conversation last night at dinner, corporal punishment. I mean, generally writing, I'm trying my best. I'm trying very hard not to make any statement, really. I mean, I'm trying to touch things that might tempt me towards a statement, to deal with it very fleetingly. But of course, the element of regret is there, but I don't think, at least not what I was trying to convey, that the mother had it in a very, for want of a better term, philosophical sense of corporal punishment, regretting it. I mean, it's just that anything that brings a certain amount of pain to that person, even though it was justified at the time, I'm not saying the licks was justified, I have a different view on that, but I'm saying if you and I were there today and we argued, and you really deserve what I told you, but you die tomorrow, it's a very human thing of feeling regret about that being one of the last things that, one of the last things that marked our last encounter before you totally went away. So no, I'm not trying to make a statement on it. I do agree with you about the kind of nostalgia that we have about getting licks and so on in the Caribbean, which I don't particularly understand. Well, no, I understand. I wonder if to go into licks again.
All right.
but yeah, I mean, it's something that, one, I don't I understand it, and I mean, it's, I think it's very connected to our history, and it's not just domestic. I think it's the way, as I was saying last night, the way a policeman speaks to you initially. There's a sense in which our idea of order is still based on brute force, right? And we don't see anything outside of brute force being able to accomplish order easily.
I don't want to end on brute force, so let me just get in my I had two final questions, but I don't think we have time for two. I'll just tell you what one is and ask the last one. One is, how do you see yourself improving over the years? What are some of your projections? But don't answer. I don't think you have time to answer. The one I really want to ask you, though, is, what is the most important advice you would give to young people who may perhaps hear this, what we've spoken about today, they must see you on TV next few weeks, and they want to write, or that writing instinct is being stirred in them. What are some of the basic rules or suggestion or some advice you'd want to impart?
There's a lot that one could say about that, and you know, covering different aspects of what it is that you'll be doing. But I think one of the things that's important and crucial for us to have now, and I guess that is intrinsically connected with the idea of BOCAS, is about a certain kind of commitment to the Caribbean as a space, which historically we have not had. Sometimes out of necessity people had to leave and so on. And we don't want to discourage people from leaving. And leaving does not necessarily preclude commitment. However, you know, I was at a book fair in St. Martin recently and talking to another writer, Unia Kempadu, who, you know, Unia Kempadu has published 3 books. She's a really big writer. But what does Unia do? Unia lives in Grenada and she runs a library, you know, because the National Library was gone or whatever, and she really and truly decided to do that, you know? And, you know, I guess it ties into the other question that you wanted to ask, so I guess I'll end up answering it without going on long. In that, one of the things I've learned recently, and I guess it'll be good advice to a Caribbean writer, I hope so too, is that, okay, we're in the Caribbean and we are aware of our shortcomings. But as a writer or as somebody, one of the aspirations I have is to stay in the Caribbean as long as I can, right? To be able to live, work, and stay in the Caribbean. And I'm not sentimentalizing the entire thing. I'm just saying that's one thing I want to do, and I believe that is necessary for the work that I want to do. We all come to poetry and art from different places. But one of the things I learned is the ability to be able to deal with the Caribbean as it is, even while trying to change it, right? You're trying to change it, but you're able to understand, listen, you don't have unrealistic expectations, right? Let's say a place like St. Lucia, you don't have many people, for instance, going off to university. So you understand that you have to deal with the ramifications of that, even while you're trying to change it. And I guess we normally have a lack of patience with dealing with the Caribbean. We constantly say, this place ain't ready yet, and we're gone. But who's going to change the place? Who's going to get it ready? Who's going to make it into the kind of place we want to stay in? Is the Caribbean going to constantly have to be a place where we feel like we have to leave? You understand? And I mean, I guess it's I don't know about Trinidad, because Trinidad is a little more, Trinidad and Tobago is a little more economically well endowed, right? However, come from a place like St. Lucia, it's a place where people constantly just understand that after you finish a certain level of wherever, at a certain age, it's time to leave and don't bother to come back and look back. So, I mean, I think for the Caribbean writer, or even within Trinidad and Tobago, you have persons who come from impoverished households or whatever. Yes, you could go out into the world, but there needs to be a certain amount of commitment. Just like people who go, they send back remittances. That is commitment in some degree, right? But there needs to be that level of commitment to the Caribbean and making it into the space that we want.
Beautiful. I prefer to end on that note. Thank you so much, Vladimir. We appreciate it.